Okay, so we will start with our radiation chapter, because we will continue. We have already completed one class on radiation, and this being the second class session. We will have a look at the syllabus which we people have already covered, like basic concepts, emission characteristics, laws of black body radiation, radiation incident on a surface, solid angle and radiation intensity. Solid angle and radiation intensity and heat exchange by radiation between two finite black surfaces and shifter and some problems on it we will be covering in this class session. So up till radiation incident on a surface we have covered in the first class session, and the remaining things we will be covering in the second class session. So we have only two class sessions, that is first and second for radiation. So things which we will be covering in the second class is radiation from a surface which has solid angle, spectral intensity of radiation, radiation intensity, Lambert's cosine law, secondly radiosity, and thirdly radiation view or shape factor which has view factor integral, view factor relations, and lastly black body radiation and some numerical on it. So radiation from a surface, a body is propagating radiation in all directions, plus it is receiving radiation in all directions. So it all depends upon the directional distribution. So such a directional effect will introduce a concept called radiation intensity. So at what intensity a body receives radiation, or at what intensity a body emits radiation, it all depends upon the shape of that object. This is what is the concept of radiation intensity. The most important concept to understand is solid angle. And we have a figure over here and plus a definition. I will just read out the definition first, and then we will move on to the figure in order to understand what the definition means to say. A solid angle is defined as the ratio of area of spherical surface enclosed by a conical surface with the vertex of the cone at the center of a sphere to the square of the radius of the sphere. This is what the definition tells. Suppose we have a sphere which is having some radius r, and on that sphere I consider an elemental area dAn. Now this elemental area dAn, if it is treated as a base of a cone, and if the apex or the vertex of the cone is lying at the center point of the sphere, as we can see from the figure, and the axis of this cone is making an angle of theta with the normal. Now the area which is available at the center of the sphere is area dA1, and that particular area is perpendicular to the normal n. So from this area dAn the radiation is getting emitted, and of course there are two circumferential directions being considered, that is phi along with the horizontal plane and theta in the vertical plane. So as per the definition, this solid angle is that area, differential area An, divided by the square of the radius. That itself tells us the mathematical representation of the definition of solid angle. So I will just read out the definition once again so that we will understand the mathematical representation of that definition. A solid angle is defined as the ratio of the area of spherical surface. That area of the spherical surface is dAn, enclosed by a conical surface with the vertex of the cone at the center of the sphere. So the vertex of the cone is at the center of the sphere, and at that point also we are finding an area dA1, divided by the square of the radius of the sphere. So the radius of the sphere is r, and the square of the radius is r square. So dAn by r square is equal to d omega is the solid angle. Now this solid angle is measured in steradians, and suppose we want to know the solid angle subtended by a hemisphere. Of course we know half part of a sphere is a hemisphere, and the solid angle which is subtended by hemisphere at the center of the sphere. So we would take up the area of the hemisphere, and the area of a sphere of course is 4 pi r square, and half of a sphere its area will be 2 pi r square, that is 4 pi r square divided by 2, and definitely this 2 pi r square divided by r square we would get 2 pi. So the solid angle is 2 pi steradians, and if it is a full sphere then it would be 4 pi r square divided by r square, and we would get 4 pi. We will move on to the next top aspect, that is spectral intensity of radiation. So it is the radiant energy emitted by a black body at a temperature T streaming through a unit area normal to the direction of propagation per unit wavelength, about a wavelength per unit solid angle, about the direction of propagation of beam. This is what the definition tells. Now if we can see, the slide shows us the mathematical representation of this definition, that is IB lambda, that is intensity of radiation of a black body B, suffix small b indicates black body, and lambda indicates the at that particular wavelength. So it is defined as the energy emitted divided by the projected area multiplied by the wavelength and the solid angle. So we are finding projected area, wavelength and solid angle in the denominator, and energy emitted in the numerator. So the unit of spectral intensity of radiation would be watt per meter square micrometer steradian, SR. So watt is the unit of energy emitted, meter square is the unit for area, micrometer is the unit for the wavelength, and SR, that is steradian, is the unit for solid angle. If you take up radiation intensity, see the radiation emitted by a body at temperature T over all wavelength per unit projected area per unit solid angle would be radiation intensity. So whatever is the spectral intensity of radiation IB lambda, I will integrate it with limits 0 to infinity IB lambda d lambda. So what would happen is your micrometer, that is unit of wavelength, would get cancelled. So the radiation intensity IB will have a unit of watt per meter square steradian. In the sense, energy emitted per unit area and per unit solid angle, that itself is radiation intensity. Whereas spectral intensity of radiation would be energy emitted per unit area, per unit wavelength and per unit solid angle. So this is the major difference between intensity of radiation and radiation intensity. And the notation for spectral intensity of radiation will be I beta lambda, whereas for radiation intensity it would be only IB. So we would not be using lambda as a suffix. Now this projected area on a plane normal to the line joining dA1 and dAn would be dA1 cos theta. We will be taking the horizontal component. So instead of dAn, I would be, we know that your d omega is dAn by r square as per the definition of solid angle, that is the projected area divided by the square of the radius is d omega. So I would rewrite this equation of I b lambda, that is intensity of spectral intensity of radiation as dq by d lambda divided by dA1 cos theta into dAn by r square. Means d omega is being replaced by dAn by r square and dAn is replaced by dA1 cos theta. If we can see, this is the hemisphere and we are considering a hatched portion, small elemental area on the surface of the sphere, and theta is the angle made by the normal, vertical normal, or the vertical axis of the sphere, and d theta is the small angle subtended by this area dAn, and d phi of course is another circumferential parameter, but it is along the horizontal plane, and we have an area dA1 at the center or the center of the sphere. So the element dAn subtends a solid angle d theta d phi sine theta, and the area dAn would be r square sine theta d phi. Of course, this is all in spherical coordinates. If we go back into the basic concepts of spherical coordinates, which people have used in unit number 1, I think things should be more clear. It is a repetition of it. Now this picture would give more insights into how actually this dAn is being defined, and how d omega is, that is solid angle, is elemental solid angle is defined. So r is the radius of the sphere, and r d theta is the one dimension of that elemental strip of that area dAn which is being considered, and r sin theta d phi is the other end of the elemental strip. So if I multiply r d theta with r sin theta d phi, we would get the area dAn, that is r square sin theta d phi. Of course, r sin theta is one of the parameter, one of the coordinate, and theta is the circumferential coordinate, but it is in the vertical plane. Phi is another circumferential coordinate for a sphere, and it is about the horizontal plane. Now, this relation of emissive power with the intensity of radiation can be proved, that your intensity of radiation IB for a black body would be quite less as compared to the total emissive power. So the total emissive power for black body is pi times that of intensity of radiation. We all know what is the value of pi, that is 22/7, and 22/7 is greater than 1, so definitely total emissive power of a black body would be quite more as compared to the intensity of radiation. We will move on to Lambert's cosine law. This Lambert's cosine law states that the total emission from a surface in any direction is directly proportional to the cosine of the angle of emission. So if En is the total emissive power in normal direction, then the emissive power is defined as E is equal to En cos theta. So since cos is a function which is being used there, we name this as Lambert's cosine law. So when we know what is the total emissive power in the normal direction, and we know what is the angle at which the radiation is being received, then we will be able to estimate what actually is the total emission from a surface. That is E is equal to En cos theta. This was primarily given by Lambert, and hence it is named as Lambert cosine law. We'll try to understand one another concept called radiosity, and I'll just read out the definition, and we would try to conceptualize the definition by a pictorial figure. Basically, the total energy which is radiated, and it has primarily two components. The one which is emitted and the one which got reflected. So whatever is radiated, part of it will be emitted and part of it will be reflected. So what the definition of radiosity tells us, that it is the total radiant energy leaving a surface per unit area per unit time. But this total radiant energy leaving a surface consists of emitted energy and the reflected part of the incident energy. Now, if we can see this figure, that there is a incident radiation and it is denoted by capital G, and part of it is reflected and part of it is emitted. So the reflected part is rho into G. As we can recall, rho is the reflectivity, which we people have taken the notation, and G of course is the irradiation or incident radiation. And the emitted one is of course epsilon multiplied by Eb, that is Eb is the emissive power of a black body and epsilon being emissivity. Now J, that is radiosity, is the sum of these two, wherein J is the radiosity of the surface measured in watt per meter square and epsilon is the emissivity of the surface. Eb is the black body emissive power at the temperature of the surface, that is watt per meter square, and rho of course is the reflectivity of the surface, and G is incident radiant flux, which is again measured in watt per meter square. So epsilon doesn't have any unit, rho doesn't have any unit, and the unit of J, Eb and G all are watt per meter square. The next topic is radiation view factor or shape factor, and this is the most important topic. We will understand certain it pictorially also, and we will try to solve certain numericals also on it, so that things would be quite clear. And I will also give you the page numbers which you need to refer to while solving problems based on view factor. Of course, we all are using the same data handbook, that is C.P. Kodandraman. As for the definition, what it tells is that radiant energy leaving the surface I and that reaches the surface J directly divided by the total energy leaving the surfaces I. Now, if you can see, there are, for any radiation exchange to take place, there should be two surfaces. And suppose I have two surfaces, I name those surfaces as I and J. And suppose I measure the radiant energy which is leaving the surface I and which reaches the surface J directly, divided by the total energy leaving the surface I. The meaning is, whatever energy is leaving the surface I, everything is not reaching the surface J. So part of the energy leaving the surface I is directly reaching the surface J. If I consider that part as and put it in the numerator, and whatever total energy is leaving the surface I, that I put it in the denominator. So this ratio, if I take, that itself is a view factor. And definitely we have energy and energy both in the numerator and denominator, so this becomes a non-dimensional entity. So the general notation for the view factor is capital F suffix I hyphen J. The meaning is I is one surface and J is one surface. So this view factor F I hyphen J is denoting the view factor of I with respect to J. Means I is, the energy is leaving from I and reaching J. Suppose on the contrary, I can write this as F suffix J hyphen I. The meaning is, the definition would be radiant energy leaving surface J and that reaches the surface I directly divided by the total energy leaving the surface J. So whatever part of J is coming out and reaching the surface I, that would be in the numerator, and whatever energy is emitted from the surface J, that would be in the denominator. So we can write Fij or Fji. So the definition is mathematically written and it's quite clear. If I write F suffix I hyphen I. The meaning is it is a fraction of energy, radiant energy, which leaves from surface I and strikes back directly to the surface I. So whatever is emitted from surface I, and that itself, part of it strikes back to the surface I, then we write it as F I hyphen I. I can even write this as F suffix J hyphen J, means the fraction of the radiation energy leaving the surface J that strikes itself directly again back to surface J. So like this, this view factor of course gives us what part of the energy is reaching the opposite surface, and it is a very important factor in radiation chapter. So different people and different books have named it as the so many synonyms for it, or so many names given for it. So some people name it as shape factor, some people name it as angle factor, geometric factor, configuration factor, and so on. So all means the same thing, that is, it is a view factor or shape factor in general. Suppose we consider two bodies, one and two, and the first body, which are exchanging heat, of course, and the area of the first body is A1 and temperature is T1, and the second body is having an area of A2 and it is at temperature T2, and whatever heat is emitted from surface 1, it is reaching surface 2, and part of it is of course reaching surface 2. Now N1 is the normal which is drawn to surface 1, and the elemental area which is considered on surface 1 is dA1, and this normal N1 is only with respect to surface 1. Likewise, we have N2 which is a normal to the surface 2, and of course we are finding that surface 2 is a bit inclined, whereas we are finding that surface 1 is horizontal in nature. Now if we take up the line which is joining between this elemental area dA1 and the elemental area dA2 on the surface 2, that line distance is denoted as small s. And beta 1 of course is the angle made by this line which is joining between these two surfaces with the normal, that is angle beta 1. And angle beta 2 is the angle made by this line S, which is joining these two surfaces with the normal N2, which is with respect to surface 2. So there is a radiation exchange taking place between these two elemental surfaces, that is area dA1 and dA2. Now if we take up projection of dA1 on the line joining the center, is dA1 cos beta 1. From the definition of radiation intensity, the rate at which radiation energy leaving dA1 and strikes dA2 will be expressed as dQ1 hyphen 2, means leaving 1 and reaching 2, will be IB1 dA1 cos beta 1 d omega 1 hyphen 2. D omega 1 hyphen 2 is defined as dA2 cos beta 2 divided by S square. S of course is the distance. The square of that distance as per the definition of solid angle. So I will substitute D omega 1 hyphen 2 as dA2 cos beta 2 divided by S square. So when I substitute this, the resulting expression would be dQ1 hyphen 2 will be equal to IB1 cos beta 1 cos beta 2 dA1 dA2 divided by S square. But we know that IB is equal to EB divided by pi. That is, IB is of course intensity of radiation and EB being the emissive power. So it is with respect to surface 1, so we will replace IB1 as EB1 divided by pi. So when I replace IB1 as EB1 divided by pi, we will, the equation changes to Eb1 cos beta 1 cos beta 2 dA1 dA2 divided by pi s square. We'll move on to the view factor integral. So this we have two differentials, that is dA1 and dA2, and if I apply the double differential with the areas A1 and A2, and also from the definition of the view factor, that is F12, view factor of 1 with respect to 2, that is Q1 hyphen 2 divided by A1 EB1, that would be the emissive, the total radiation emitted from body 1. And Q12, of course, is the total energy which is radiated from body 1 and it is reaching body 2. So this F12, I will just substitute this Q12 from the earlier equation in this definition for the view factor. So it would be 1 divided by A1 double integral A1 A2 cos beta 1 cos beta 2 divided by pi s square into dA1 dA2. Now if we can even write the equation for view factor F21, and instead of taking the, we can see this is 1 divided by A1 and this formula would be 1 divided by A2 double integral A1 A2 cos beta 1 cos beta 2 pi s square dA1 dA2. So the net energy would, which is exchanging, would be Q1 hyphen 2 minus Q suffix 2 hyphen 1. So I would substitute Q12 and Q21 as A1 F12 EB1 minus EB2 minus A2 into F21 EB1 minus EB2. So this EB1 EB2 of course is with respect to a black body, and if we write it in terms of radiosities, we would write it as J1 and J2, because J1 and J2 are the notations taken for radiosities. We will try to understand the view factor relations. If we can see, we are finding three different figures, the first one being a flat surface, the second is convex surface, and the third one is concave surface. Suppose this flat surface is emitting certain radiation in all directions, but what is happening is, I call that surface as I, and whatever is emitted is not reaching again back because it is totally a flat surface and it is getting emitted in all directions but isn't reaching back to its own surface, that is I. So FII would be zero for a perfectly flat surface. The second figure shows us a convex surface, that at one any given point on the convex surface, there is certain radiation which is getting emitted. So even that energy which is emitted is not reaching back to the same surface I. So even the view factor or shape factor for such surfaces Fi hyphen I would be zero. So for a convex surface it is zero, and for a flat surface it is zero. If you take up a concave surface, so whatever energy is emitted, so there is a possibility that this energy which is getting emitted will fall back on the same surface on the other end. Why? Because it is just like a cup shape or a saucer shape concave surface. So for such objects, the F II would not be zero. If we consider two surfaces wherein the two surfaces are so large enough that their heights are imagined to be as infinity, so whatever radiation F1 view factor 1 F12 will be equal to F21 and both will be 1. So whatever is emitted from 1 will fall on 2, and whatever is emitted from 2, everything will fall on 1. So F12 and F21 is equal to 1 provided both surfaces 1 and 2 are treated to be infinite in height or length or whatever. Suppose in the figure B we are finding that there is a flat surface and its length is infinite in nature. Now if we take one small object 1, which is, say it is in the form of a very small steel ball or something like that, and it is very small in the size as compared to the surface 2. So we can imagine and write that the view factor F12 is half, in the sense view factor 1 with respect to 2, in the sense whatever is emitted from 1 will fall, half of it will fall on surface 2 and the half will get diffused in the environment. But on the other case, whatever is emitted from 2, negligible part of it will fall on 1 because the total surface area of 1 is very small. So we will write it as F suffix 2 hyphen 1 tending to 0. Now if we take up the third figure, we have two surfaces which are perpendicular, and the second surface, these two surfaces, is projecting to infinity, whereas this one surface is very small. So this one surface, if we write the shape factor F12, it will be half, in the sense whatever is emitted from 1, 50% of it will fall on 2, that is the possibility of it. But on the contrary, if you take up F21, which is an adjacent surface, but its area is tending to infinity, then negligible part of it will fall on surface 1 because the surface area of 1 is quite small as compared to surface area 2. So F21 is tending to 0. There is a reciprocity rule which tells us A1 F12 is equal to A2 F21, and it is a very important rule and it is very useful in determining one view factor from the knowledge of the other. So if we know this reciprocity rule, will allow us to calculate any one unknown provided any three of these are known. There is a summation rule wherein it is based on the conservation of energy principle, which tells us that the entire radiation leaving a surface I must be absorbed by all surfaces of the enclosure. In the sense, so the sum of the view factors from surface I of an enclosure with respect to all the surfaces of the enclosure, including to itself, must be unity. This is a summation rule. So Fi hyphen j is equal to 1. So if there are n number of surfaces and I keep on naming them as I is equal to 1 to n, so I can write this as Fi hyphen j, and when I summate everything it results to 1 because energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. So it is based on law of conservation of energy. Suppose I have an enclosure and T1, T2, T3, so on, these are surfaces, and I keep on naming those surfaces and ultimately I reach a number called Ti, and there are n number of surfaces, Tn. So definitely the one which is before Tn will be Tn minus 1 and ultimately Ti and so on up till T1. So what would I write is F11 plus F12 plus F13 and so on up till F1n. If I add everything, that will be 1. So F21 plus F22 plus F23, so on up till F2n, that again will be 1. So F31, 32, 33, so on, 3n is 1. So the meaning is Fn1, n2, n3, so nn, that would be 1. So this is a summation rule. So the n by 2 into n minus 1 view factors can be obtained from n by 2 into n minus 1 reciprocity relations. So according to the total number of view factors to be evaluated directly for n surfaces enclosure, means a enclosure having n number of surfaces, it will be n by 2 into n minus 1. Now the remaining view factors which are there, they can be obtained from the summation rules. See, this summation rule itself gives us so many number of equations. Using these equations, we can solve the remaining unknowns. Now, to understand this, we will take an example. We have three surfaces, of course, named as A1, A3, and A4. And I will name the surface A2 as a sum of A3 and A4. Now, the view factor F12 between the two surfaces A1 and A2 is equal to the sum of the view factors F13 and F14. If the two areas A3 and A4 make up together to form the area A2. So, area A2 is the sum of A3 and A4. So, A1 is the area and A3 plus A4 is A2. So, we will just see how to write the equation. So, the additive relation will tell us that F12 is equal to F13 plus F14 because the area 3 plus 4 is nothing but 2. And if both the sides are multiplied by A1, then we will find the equation being written as A1 F12 is equal to A1 F13 plus A1 F14. And by reciprocity rule, we can write it as A2 F21 is equal to A3 F31 plus A4 F41 because the areas 3 plus 4 is added together would make up area A2. Now I can write this F21 as A3 F31 plus A4 F41 divided by A2. Suppose the area A2 is not divided only in two parts and it is divided in n number of parts. So of course this diagram shows us that it is being divided into two parts. We can even divide it into n number of parts. So I can write A2 as A3 plus A4 so on up till AN. So if I add all those areas, n number of areas, I will get area A2. So F21 I can write it as A3 F31 plus A4 F41 plus A5 F51 and so on, AN FN minus 1, N1. So divided by A2 will give us the shape factor F21. We'll understand what is the symmetry rule. In the sense, I have got a rectangular box. Of course, this is visible in the form of a square, wherein L is equal to H. It is being written that the height of the square and the length of the square are equal, but actually it is a box. And this box has got a diagonal partition, and that diagonal partition is named as surface area 1. Whereas the base is surface area 3 and the height of the box is surface area 2. So F12 will be equal to F13 provided L is equal to H. So this is called symmetry rule. The meaning is whatever is emitted from 1 and whatever reaches area 2, whatever radiation reaches 2 and whatever is coming out from surface 1 and the part of which reaches 3, both are equal. So whatever radiation is emitted from surface 1, half of it will go to surface 2 and half of it will go to surface 3. This is what it means to say. So these are the rules, that is view factor relations. Of course, we have for flat surface, for convex surface, for concave surface. And we also know how to write view factors for infinite objects. We have learned what is reciprocity rule. We have learned what is a summation rule. We have learned what is a reciprocity relation. And also the additive relation we people have studied. And the symmetry rule also we people have studied. Now we'll move on to black body radiation. Suppose we are having two surface areas, A1 and A2, and of course the rate of energy from one leaves and falls on the second surface. So whatever leaves, the rate at which energy leaves from surface 1 and reaches surface 2, that we have already know how to write the equation, that is A1 F12 EB1 is equal to A1 F12 sigma T1 to the power 4, and this Eb1, we are finding it that it is being replaced as sigma T1 to the power 4. It is as per Stefan Boltzmann's law. Similarly, whatever energy leaves from the surface 2 and reaches surface 1, that is Q21 is equal to A2F21 Eb2 is equal to A2F21 sigma T2 to the power 4. So definitely it is Q12 and Q21, see both equations are being written. Now whatever is the net exchange between these two surfaces would be A1F12 sigma T1 to the power 4 minus T2 to the power 4, or A2F21 sigma T1 to the power 4 minus T2 to the power 4. So this is nothing but your Stefan Boltzmann's law, whereas sigma is the Stefan Boltzmann's constant, F is the shape factor which we people already learnt, and A1 and A2 are nothing but the areas. So suppose an enclosure consists of n black surfaces, and the radiation heat transfer from any surface I of the enclosure is the sum of the radiation of heat transfers to each of the surface of the enclosure from surface I. So this summation can also be written from J, surface I and J. So AI, FIJ, TI to the power 4 minus TJ to the power 4, right from surface 1 up till the surface N, because the enclosure is consisting of N number of surfaces. So we'll discuss certain numerical, the first being numerical is expecting us to calculate the view factor F12 and F21. And we are finding a sphere of diameter D, and it is enclosed in a cubical box, and the length of the box is D. So we all know that a cube has got equal sides, like length, breadth and height. And the length and breadth and height of the sphere is D, which is nothing but L. And the sphere is also having a diameter of D, and that sphere is enclosed in the box. So whatever is the area of the sphere, that is A1, and whatever is the area of the box, that is A2. So F12 will be 1, in the sense whatever is emitted from 1, everything is received by 2. So by reciprocity rule, F21 will be A1, A2, F12, and A1 of course is the area of the sphere, means 4 pi r square is nothing but the area of the sphere. It can definitely be written as pi d square, because diameter is nothing but 2 times the radius. And since the cube has got 6 square faces, and every square face of a cube is having an area of L square, so we have 6 times, if you multiply if you add L square, we get 6 L square. So pi d square by 6 L square into 1 would be pi by 6. So pi by 6 is F21. Suppose I am having a long square duct which is having a partition, and that partition is diagonal partition is having an area A1, and the height of the duct is having an area A2, and the base of the duct is having an area A3. So from summation rule, F11 plus F12 plus F13 should be 1, and wherever we have a flat surface, we know that F11 will be 0. So definitely the by symmetry F12 F plus F13 will be 1, means F12 will be equal to F13. So hence F12 will be 0.5, and by reciprocity theorem F21, that is L root 2 divided by L F12, we already know F12 is 0.5. So ultimately by reciprocal theorem, F21 will be 0.71. Suppose we are having a cylinder, and the end and the side of the circular tube of equal length and diameter. Then we have the top surface of the cylinder as area A1, bottom surface of the cylinder as area A3, and height of the cylinder is L is equal to D. So the cylinder diameter is D, and whatever is the lateral surface area of the cylinder, that is area A2. So R3 by L is equal to 0.5, L by R1 is equal to 2, then F13 will be 0.17. So if I apply the summation rule, it will be F11 plus F12 plus F13 will be 1. Now, wherever there is a flat surface, we have F11 is equal to 0, and F12 will be equal to 1 minus F13 is equal to 1 minus 0.17 is equal to 0.83. So by reciprocity rule, we will apply F21 is equal to A1 by A2, F12, and of course the surface area of the top base of the sphere and the top base of the cylinder, it is circular, so area of a circle will be pi d square by 4, and the lateral surface of the area of a cylinder is pi into d into L. So ultimately, when we substitute, we get the value as 0.21. So F21 by reciprocity rule will be 0.21. We'll solve one another problem, which is based on heat transfer between two surfaces which are kept at a certain distance apart, and both the surfaces are black in nature, and we need to refer certain data handbook. I'll just read out the problem. Two black disks of diameter 50 cm each are placed parallel to each other concentrically at a distance of 1 meter. The disks are maintained at 727 degrees centigrade and 227 degrees centigrade respectively. Calculate the heat transfer between the disks per hour when no other surface is present except the disks. Now there are two disks, 1 and 2, and each are having a diameter of 50 centimeter or radius as 25 centimeter. The both are kept 1 meter apart, and these two are having temperatures of 727 and 227 degrees centigrade. For this, we need to refer the page 97, that is 6th edition of Heat Transfer Data Handbook. So there are two coaxial disks which are given of different radii, or you can take it as the same radii. And of course, along x-axis, we are given the value of L by R2. And on y-axis, it is given the value of shape factor. So when we refer to this, we would get the shape factor. So whatever heat transfer data handbook you people are having, you can, for taking down the values of to shape or view factor, they all are available from page numbers 90 to 104. This is, of course, with respect to 6th edition. So L by R1 will be 1 divided by 0.25. It will be 4. And R2 by L will be 0.25 divided by 1. That is 0.25. So F12 from the graph will be 0.06. Now, if you take up the heat transfer rate, that is Q is equal to F12A into sigma T1 to the power 4 minus T2 to the power 4. So you would substitute the values. Why? Because there is F12, we have referred it from the graph, that is data handbook. We will get it as 0.06. And pi by 4 into D square, that is D is of course 0.5. That is 50 centimeters is 0.5 meters. And I would substitute the value of Stefan Boltzmann's constant, that is 5.67 into 10 raised to minus 8. And we have converted all the temperatures to Kelvin. So we have 1000 Kelvin to the power 4 minus 500 Kelvin to the power 4. And when I substitute everything, we get a value of 626.24 Watt. But we need to express that in kilojoule. So the problem is expecting us to find kilojoule, or we can express it as kilojoule per hour. So it will be 2.254 into 10 raised to 6 joule per hour. This is of course joule per second. So when we multiply it by 3600, we get it joule per hour. And again, when we multiply it by 10 raised to 3, we get it around 2254.46 kilojoule per hour. So this is the end of radiation. And if you have any doubts, you can definitely contact.